Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Bryan Lynn presents this week's technology report. He tells us about ways tech leaders and governments are working to make sure AI systems are safe to build and use. Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins bring us today's lesson of the day. But first, this report. If you have flown on an airplane before, you might have experienced turbulence. Turbulence is a sudden movement of air. It can move the plane around and force sudden changes in height. Flying through mild turbulence feels like driving a car over big bumps or holes in the road. But passengers on a Singapore Airlines flight on Tuesday experienced severe turbulence. Several people were injured and one person, a 73-year-old British man, died. The exact cause of the man's death is still unclear. While turbulence-related deaths are rare, injuries have increased over the years. Some weather and aviation experts have noted increasing reports of turbulence. They say climate change may be behind the increase.
Turbulence is unstable air that moves unpredictably. Most people link it with heavy storms. But the most dangerous kind is clear air turbulence. This often happens with no warning signs in the sky ahead. Clear air turbulence happens most often in or near rivers of air called jet streams. The cause is something called wind shear. That is when two huge air masses near each other move at different speeds. If the difference in speed is big enough, it breaks into circular movements. Thomas Gwynn is an aviation science expert at the Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in Daytona Beach, Florida. He said, when you get strong wind shear near the jet stream, it can cause the air to overflow, and that creates these chaotic motions in the air.
The U.S. National Transportation Safety Board, NTSB, reported that more than one-third of all airline incidents in the U.S. from 2009 to 2018 were related to turbulence. Most of them resulted in one or more serious injuries to passengers, but no damage to the plane. Between 2009 and 2022, the NTSB said 163 people were injured seriously enough during turbulence events to require hospital treatment for at least 2 days. Most of those injured were flight attendants. They are especially at risk because they are more likely to be out of their seats during a flight. Singapore Airlines said its plane dropped about 1,800 meters in about 3 minutes last Tuesday after hitting severe turbulence over the Indian Ocean. In addition to the one death, 6 or 7 passengers were severely injured. Several others suffered less serious injuries. Larry Kornman is a scientist at the U.S. National Center for Atmospheric Research. He has studied turbulence for many years. He said, "It's not uncommon to have turbulence encounters that cause minor injuries, up to, say, a broken bone. but fatalities are very, very rare, especially for large transport aircraft. Stuart Fox is with the International Air Transport Association. He said until Tuesday, it had been 27 years since a passenger died following clear air turbulence on a major airline.
Pilots use several methods to avoid turbulence, including using weather radar images. Sometimes they can simply see and fly around the storms. But clear air turbulence can happen unexpectedly. Doug Moss is a former airline pilot and safety expert. He said air traffic controllers will warn pilots after another plane runs into clear air turbulence. Many pilots also look at the upper-level jet streams along their flight path for signs of wind shear. They can plan to move above, below, or around those areas, he added.
Some scientists note that reports of turbulence encounters are on the rise. There are several possible explanations for that. But several researchers have pointed to climate change. Gwynn of Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University explained that some experts predict climate change could change the jet stream and increase the wind shear. This would drive up turbulence in the air. Paul Williams is a professor of atmospheric science at Britain's University of Reading. In a statement Tuesday, he said there was strong evidence that turbulence is increasing because of climate change. Williams said his research team recently discovered that severe clear air turbulence in the North Atlantic has increased by 55% since 1979. The team estimated that severe turbulence in the jet streams could double or triple in the coming years under current conditions. Other experts note that an increase in air travel could be the reason for the increase in turbulence encounters.
Turbulence can be hard to predict, but experts note that the first line of defense in the air is keeping seatbelts fastened whenever possible. Wear your seatbelt, Gwynn said. That's just a really quick fix to prevent injury. I'm John Russell.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.
Major AI developers and top government officials have agreed on measures that aim to ensure that artificial intelligence, AI, systems are safely built and deployed. The announcement came at the end of a two-day meeting in Seoul, South Korea. The gathering continues discussions from a similar event held last November in Britain. The goal of both meetings was to bring AI developers together with government representatives to establish goals and guidelines related to safe AI development. Many governments and international organizations across the world are seeking to create rules for AI technology development. Officials and activists have raised concerns that AI systems could present risks. The concerns include AI possibly attacking online systems controlling infrastructure. Another concern is that AI systems might help spread misinformation or create deepfakes to mislead voters in elections. legislative attempts to create rules for AI development, especially in the United States, have not been successful. Last October, President Joe Biden issued an executive order calling on companies working on AI projects to develop guidelines for protecting users of the technology. At the latest meeting, officials from 16 different technology companies signed a voluntary agreement on Tuesday. In it, they promised to develop AI technology in ways that limit possible harm to the public. Among the companies were American-based Google, IBM, Amazon, Microsoft, and OpenAI. Others included China's Alibaba and Tencent, as well as South Korea's Samsung Electronics and G42 from the United Arab Emirates. The British government co-led the summit with South Korea. It said in a statement that the leaders in attendance sought to establish a common understanding of AI safety and align their AI research. One of the main parts of the latest agreement calls for creating a network of publicly supported safety institutes designed to guide research and testing of AI technologies. Some of these institutes have already been set up by Britain, the U.S., and Singapore. United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres told the meeting through a video link that AI technology has continued to quickly develop since the group's last meeting in Britain. Such development had led to life-changing technological advances, but Guterres added that the progress had also created life-threatening new risks. "We cannot sleepwalk into a dystopian future," he added, "where the power of AI is controlled by a few people, or worse, by algorithms beyond human understanding," he said. Earlier this year, the UN General Assembly approved its first resolution on AI. The measure received support from all 193 UN member states. It called for international efforts to ensure that new technologies help all nations respect human rights and stay safe, secure, and trustworthy. Attendees agreed on the need for AI companies to exchange ideas on their progress and development methods. The group also agreed to provide information on safety. South Korea's Science and Information Minister Lee Jong-ho spoke to the gathering before it ended on Wednesday. He said worldwide AI development had reached a point where cooperation is not an option, it is a necessity. AI experts welcomed the steps to start creating rules or regulations to keep the technology safe, but some noted that such rules need to be enforced to be effective. Francine Bennett is director of the AI-centered Ada Lovelace Institute in Britain. She told Reuters news agency, "We need to move past voluntary. The people affected should be setting the rules via governments. AI companies should be able to prove their products meet established regulations before they even reach the market," said Max Tegmark. He is president of the Future of Life Institute, a nonprofit bringing attention to the risks of AI. Tegmark said companies should equate safety with profit and attempt to limit possible harms during the development of systems. South Korean Minister Lee said a big problem is that any laws aimed at making AI systems safer are far behind continuous development and public releases, he told Reuters. But for safe use by the public, there needs to be flexible laws and regulations in place. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me to talk about his technology report. Hi, Bryan. Thanks for being here.
Of course, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, you reported on an international meeting of tech companies and officials seeking to establish safety guidelines for developing and deploying AI. What were some of the biggest concerns expressed about this fast-progressing technology?
So at this particular meeting, government representatives seemed centered on areas where we have already seen cases of AI being misused, such as chatbots spreading misinformation or creating deepfakes, the false videos that can make it appear individuals are saying things that they actually did not say. And we've already seen how misinformation can be a problem as well. AI tools have now been added to search engines and other online systems. These can, for example, contain false, outdated, or misleading information, and many users are not likely to take steps to verify the facts on their own.
What other possible threats were discussed?
Well, another big issue for some nations, especially in places like Britain and the European Union, is the threat of AI taking over jobs across numerous industries, leading to high unemployment rates. And the group said this is one important issue that must be dealt with now, even if we haven't yet seen major job losses due to AI. Another big concern was AI systems being used to control energy systems, the fear being that AI could make a disastrous mistake or may even attack various energy systems to cause harm.
All right. Thanks so much for that report, Bryan, and thank you for joining me.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In Lesson 37 of the series, Ana finds a backpack outside her office building and tries to find the person it belongs to. Let's listen.
You know, I am from the country, and sometimes I miss it. But I really like life in the city. I love the city. Oh, look, someone lost a bag. Maybe it's theirs. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be hers.
Thank you. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be his.
Thank you. Hello. Is this bag yours?
Yes, that's mine. These are all my travel things. Thank you. Thank you.
Luckily for this traveler, Anna found his bag and brought it to him.
Anna was thinking to herself,
I wonder whose bag this is.
That's whose, spelled W-H-O-S-E, which refers to possession. That means to whom the object or idea belongs.
Right. So if you find something and you're not sure whose it is, one thing you can ask is,
whose is this?
Remember that this word, whose, is spelled differently than the contraction of the two words, who is. Those two words form a subject and verb, like this.
Who's the president of the United States?
The contraction and the possessive adjective both sound the same. They are both pronounced with the sound of the letter Z at the end.
Whose bag is this? Who's the president of the United States?
And when we talk about to whom something belongs, we use possessive pronouns. We heard these when Anna was trying to find out whose bag she found.
Oh, look! Someone lost a bag. Maybe it's theirs. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be hers.
Thank you. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be his.
Thank you. Hello, is this bag yours?
Yes, that's mine. These are all my travel things. Thank you. Thank you.
You'll notice that these possessive pronouns sound almost the same as possessive adjectives. For example, the adjective form of the pronoun you is your.
Like when we say, this is your bag.
And then for the possessive pronoun, we just add the letter S. For example,
this bag is yours.
But notice that the S at the end sounds like the letter Z. Z.
Yours.
If you listen carefully, you can hear a bit of the sound of the letter S at the end of a word like yours. So the sound of Z is not as strong or as long as in a word like zero. Instead, it's more like a Z with a little S at the end. Yours.
Now listen to these five possessive pronouns.
Yours. His, hers, ours, theirs. We'll listen to a chant at the end of today's lesson of the day to give you a fun way to practice saying these possessive pronouns.
Oh, we will. Whose idea was that?
That idea was mine.
Well, I'm not surprised. Let's go back to lesson 37 and see what the owner of the bag and Anna talk about.
Are you okay? You seem nervous.
Well, this is my first visit to Washington, D.C. I'm from a small town in the country. I feel a little lost.
I'm from the country, too. And I understand. When I first came here, I felt lost all the time.
So, do you like living in the country or in the city?
I like to live in the city.
Why?
The city is exciting. It has more culture than the country. There are many museums and restaurants. Every night, there's theater and music. And there are more jobs. That is why I'm here.
Well, I agree. There is more culture in the city. And there might be more jobs, but the country has more nature. It's peaceful and beautiful. There are more trees and mountains. The air is clean. You can go hiking and camping. The city is not beautiful. It's noisy and dirty.
I disagree. I think all the different buildings are beautiful. And I like to watch all the different people.
Anna and the man from the country.
And we should note that when the man uses the word country, he means he is from a rural area, not a city. It does not mean he's from a foreign country.
Good point. Anna and the man from the country are talking about which kind of place they prefer.
Prefer is a verb. It means to like something more compared to another thing. Anna prefers the city, while the man prefers the country.
So they are talking about their preferences.
Preference is a noun. It means the thing or the choice that you like more. And we can use it or the verb form to form a question. For example, we can ask,
which do you prefer, the city or the country?
Or if you already know or have mentioned the choices, you can just ask,
do you have a preference?
Or you can ask,
do you have a preference between the two?
Anna and the man prefer different things. In another lesson of the day, we'll listen to more of Lesson 37 of Let's Learn English and find out if Anna and the man continue to disagree or if they share some preferences.
And here's a question for our listeners. Do you have a preference between living in the city or the country? You can let us know which you prefer by writing to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. So, Andrew, we're almost out of time. How about we listen to that chant with possessive pronouns?
Okay, let's do it. And special thanks to my friend Jennifer, who helped record the chant. Here it is. Whose is this?
Whose is that?
It's his.
It's hers.
It's theirs.
It's mine.
Whose are these?
Whose are those?
They're his.
They're hers.
They're ours.
They're mine.
Is it ours?
Is it his?
Is it hers?
Is it theirs?
It's not his.
And it's not hers.
And it's not ours.
And it's not theirs.
I think it's mine.
I think it's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
Is everything yours?
Not everything's mine.
This one's yours.
And that one's hers.
And those are his.
But what about these?
These are mine.
But what about those?
Those are mine.
Are you gonna share?
Of course I'll share.
Whenever we share.
It's not just yours.
It's not just mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
And together it's ours.
I like the ending of that chant. It can feel good to share with others.
And if you enjoy the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast, we hope you will share it with other people. You can do that by finding us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram.
And you can find all of the Let's Learn English series on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.